We'd like to welcome you this morning to this joint service of Dakota Wesleyan University and Fusion Church. I'm Matt Morrison. I'm one of the pastors at Fusion. Just want to say thank you so much for joining us today. This is a great day of celebration and a great honor for us to be able to share this time with you today. A couple of quick announcements. We'll also actually take our offering at this time. If you're a regular at Fusion, we ask that you give. If you're a guest, please, especially this week, especially if you have to dig under a robe, don't feel any pressure to give whatsoever. This is primarily for our Fusion folks. It is Mother's Day today, and we want to celebrate our moms in all of their different forms. After the service, we've got a table with some treats for the ladies out there. I know for myself, I've been so blessed to have such great mother figures in my life, whether it's my own mom, whether it's watching my wife Amy with our kids, or anyone else that has nurtured me in the way that only a mother can. I'm just so thankful for that in my life, and so we want to celebrate all of you for that. We also want to acknowledge those that that mother in different ways. Not everyone has the opportunity or has been blessed with the gift of being able to do that in the physical sense at this point in time, but that makes you no less a mother. And so we want to celebrate those that have the heart of a mother and have expressed that in many different ways as well. We also want to acknowledge those that have lost mothers and grandmothers this year. I know at Fusion we've had a few folks this year. And so we know that for some today that have gathered here that it's a day of grief and a day of remembrance. And so we want you to know that we grieve along with you and we share that heart. And so we pray that today would be a good day of remembrance and a day where some comfort would be found and some encouragement would be found in those memories. Also, a little bit of business. At the end of the rows, you'll find attendance pads. We would love for you to take the opportunity to sign on in on those, pass them down the rows, and go ahead and get to know your neighbors a little bit through that. One of the great gifts that we have as a church in being able to share facilities with Dakota Wesleyan is that we don't own this building, but we get to meet here every week, which means we don't have the overhead of a building. And so you'll notice several different missions organizations on there. If you, as a first-time guest, would like to choose one of those organizations, write the number of it next to your name, we would love, as our way of saying thank you for joining us today, to be able to make a donation in your honor to that organization. Again, because we don't have the expense of a building, it frees us up to be able to give more of our resources in ministry, both locally and around the world, and this is one of the ways that we choose to do that, and so we would love for you to take part in that today. Finally, just a couple last quick announcements about things that are coming up at Fusion. Next week, we will be back to our normal service at 10 o'clock here in this room. We'll have Steve Treves speaking for us. Really looking forward to seeing what Steve brings to the table. And the week after that, we get to hear from Denise Van Meter. Very excited about hearing what's on Denise's heart and to see what happens here at Fusion over the next couple of weeks.
Would you please join me in response to our call to worship today? It is the light of God's love in Christ that brings a rich harvest of goodness and truth. So we would like to live people who belong to the light. We would have nothing to do with worthless things that belong to the world of darkness. In the name of Jesus, we would live to light, giving thanks to God the Father.
Good morning and welcome to the class of 2016. It is, it brings me great joy to see all of you. I also remember moving many of you in and hauling lots of Gatorade bottles and girls' clothing and more girls' clothing and more boxes of things that were going to be really important on your life journey as you started here at Wesleyan. And now to see you graduating, it's really the culmination of what we do here at Wesleyan, and it's such a privilege to see what happens in your growth and transformation. So if you take a moment today and just join me in prayer. Loving God, we offer thanks for your counsel and your presence in our journey. We give thanks for the family and friends who are gathered with us here today, or who may be at a distance, who offered support. For the faculty and staff who mentored and advised. for the lifelong friends who may sit next to us here, whose relationships pulled us through difficult times, and with whom we celebrated all of our accomplishments. Loving God, you are a source of infinite wisdom, abundant mercy, and ever-present grace. May our actions be witnesses of your faithfulness and love, and may trust fill our souls as we move along on our journey. In your heavenly name we pray. Amen.
Now would you please join me in response to our litany of call. Life looms ahead of us, huge and uncertain. In the confusion, we must listen for the voice of God. Who can hear the voice of God calling? Here I am, send me. Expectations of the world are so overwhelming, luring us to make choices for our own comfort. Who can hear the call of God? Who will be the light in the darkness? Here I am, send me. Hunger, greed, hopelessness prevail in our world, making it difficult to believe that God still exists. Who can speak good news in the face of evil? Here I am, send me. Our voice seems so small against the misery we hear. Wars and famines and abuse seem dominant. Who can be heard above the crying? Here I am, send me. The world is waiting to hear the promise of God, a life of justice, peace, and love for all of God's children. Who will be the light in the darkness? Here I am, send me.
Will Ariana please come forward? While she's coming up, I have to say it's remarkable that we should have this presentation right after the litany that we just had. In honor of the 12 years Bishop A.J. Armstrong served in the Dakotas, the Dakota Wesleyan University Board of Trustees established the Bishop Armstrong Peace and Justice Award to be presented annually to a student or staff person whose life has demonstrated the relationship between religious faith and issues of peace and justice. This year's award goes to Ariana Arampatus. One of the marks of a commitment to peace and justice is the willingness to walk alongside those who live on the margins. Ariana, you have exhibited this willingness in your work with such activities as the Salvation Army's Kids Club and the Lutheran Social Services Center for New Americans. A second arena of your involvement in promoting peace and justice is your ability to understand and promote change in social and political systems in ways which enhance justice. You have provided leadership for the Third Freedom in its activities seeking to reduce hunger. You have engaged in efforts to change South Dakota laws regarding the taxation of food. You have been a major contributor to the Ugandan Women's Soap Project aimed at promoting economic development. You have served in a leadership capacity for several conferences on social change. With regard to the religious roots of your commitment to peace and justice, perhaps the best testimony is your own description of your time at Dakota Wesleyan as an experience of immense growth in faith inspired by the serving hearts of so many on and off campus. This has been reflected in such diverse ways as leadership on Student Ministry Council and the infusion of faith themes in your artistic work. Ariana, for the contributions you have already made toward peace and justice, and for the promise of a life of continued servant leadership, Dakota Wesleyan University is proud to present you with the 2016 Bishop Armstrong Peace and Justice Award.
Today's scripture lesson will be taken from Revelation chapter 22, verse 1 through 7. Then the angel showed me the river of the water of life, bright as crystal, flowing from the throne of God and of the Lamb through the middle of the street of the city. Also, on either side of the river, the tree of life with its 12 kinds of fruit, yielding its fruit each month. The leaves of the tree were for the healing of the nations. No longer will there be anything accursed, but the throne of God and of the Lamb will be in it, and his servants will worship him. They will see his face, and his name will be on their foreheads, and night will be no more. They will need no light of lamp or sun, for the Lord God will be their light, and they will reign forever and ever. And he said to me, "These words are trustworthy and true. And the Lord, the God of the spirits of the prophets, has sent his angel to show his servants what must soon take place. And behold, I am coming soon. Blessed is the one who keeps the words of the prophecy of this book." This is the word of God for the people of God.
The things they carried were largely determined by necessity. Among the necessities, or near necessities, were P-38 can openers, pocket knives, heat tabs, wristwatches, dog tags, mosquito repellents, chewing gum, candy cigarettes, salt tablets, packets of Kool-Aid, lighters, matches, sewing kits, military payment certificates, sea rations, and two or three canteens of water. Altogether, these items weighed between 15 and 20 pounds, depending upon a man's habits or rate of metabolism. Henry Dobbins, who was a big man, carried extra rations. He was especially fond of canned peaches in heavy syrup over pound cake. David Jensen, who practiced field hygiene, carried a toothbrush, dental floss, and several hotel-sized bars of soap he'd stolen on R&R in Sydney, Australia. Ted Lavender, who was scared, carried tranquilizers until he was shot in the head outside the village of Than Ky in mid-April. By necessity and because it was SOP, they carried steel helmets that weighed 5 pounds, including the liner and camouflage cover. They carried the standard fatigue jackets and trousers. On their feet, they carried jungle boots, 2.1 pounds. And Dave Jensen carried 3 pairs of socks and a can of Dr. Scholl's foot powder as a precaution against trench foot. Now, you would think a novel about the Vietnam War would start differently. You'd think it would start with a battle scene, or at least an explosion sequence, a chase, a raid, the hero under fire. Well, explosions and chases, dramatic scenes like that, for Hollywood, those are SOP, standard operating procedure, for those of you that missed that. You need to start with a bang. You need to grab people's attention. But Tim O'Brien, one of the most important writers we have in this Vietnam era, starts with a list. What did the soldiers carry? What went with them through these harsh foreign climates? Why did those things matter? And I think the way that O'Brien tells his story is more than a matter of artistry, although it is that too. It's a philosophical statement, maybe even a metaphysical statement. It's a big word, but the college graduates can handle it. It may be a metaphysical statement. What do we carry with us? What do we pack, metaphorically speaking? Grudges against bosses that slighted us, anger at friends who betrayed us, despair at what we see in the world, climate change, refugee crises, terrorist threats, autocratic states, and all of us seemingly powerless against it, and those in power seemingly unable to come up with any solutions. Is that what we carry? Maybe. That's a heavy burden. Maybe it's too much.
So this is a happy day. Let's turn this metaphysical question then toward happier things. What does the DWU Tiger Class of 2016 carry with you as you go? What do you take with you? Now, I think too often we approach graduation, we approach this four-year degree with a bit too much of our Midwestern pragmatism. Now, that serves us well sometimes, but maybe we've got a bit too much of that. Maybe we reduce our four-year experience to the amount of our student debt versus our beginning salary. And yeah, that's important, okay? I get that. I'm not naive. That matters, and it matters a lot, but is that really the thing that you're going to carry with you out of here? Is that the lasting thing that you're going to carry with you from Dakota Wesleyan? I certainly hope not. I certainly hope there's more to it than that. I hope your packing list includes things with more lasting value. The memories that you'll have, to be sure. The stories that you will tell. The embarrassing moments that were snapped by your friends and now live immortally in the ether of social media. I hope you will carry with you the small victories, the classes that you passed. If there is no such thing as a t-shirt that says, "I survived organic chemistry," there should be such a thing. You will carry music recitals, you will carry choir concerts, you will carry games out on the lawns between the dorms. You will carry athletic events, club meetings, service projects, tough classes, beloved professors, best friends. But remember the context in which these things happened. Don't forget there's more to the story than that. College was not one big party. Parents, college was not one big party. What party it was, I'll let your own child explain to you, but there was real struggle involved. There was real difficulty, late nights studying, roommate drama, ugh. There were gen eds to pass. There was unwelcome pain. And for this class, especially, unexpected sorrow. There were internships, there were preceptorships, there were to-do lists that stretched as long as from here to Dayton. There was figuring out who you are, figuring out who you want to be, figuring out who you want to surround yourself with, maybe even who you want to share your life with. And no matter how worthwhile you deem those things to be, they're tough. They take work. They take effort. The struggle, as they say, is real. And you made it. So I kind of hate to break it to you, but the struggle is always real. Yeah, this is a big day for our graduates. It's a big day for their families. And those of you that are our friends, that are part of this congregation at Fusion, we've all gathered here together because it's a big day, because it's something important. So I hate to break it to you, but the problems that you see on the news, you're implicated in them, in doing something about them, in finding a solution. You don't get a degree for the sake of your own economic benefit. That's a byproduct. You get the degree because it's a launching point to do something good in the world. All those worries that we carry with us, the bigger things that are out there, you carry them too. And I kind of wish it wasn't that way, because I like you so much, but that's the way the world is. We can wish it was different, but it's not, and it never has been. When you go back and you read the book of Revelation, you find a book that tells the story of the way it's always been, of the real struggle. It was told by Christians under pressure. It was written later than most books in the Bible and comes from a community of believers who were facing systemic persecution at the hands of the Roman authorities and the Jewish authorities basically any authority. That's part of the reason that Revelation is such a confusing book, because it was too dangerous to say out loud, Jesus is Lord. You were putting yourself and your family at risk. You could lose your property, you could lose your friends, you could very literally lose your life. Like the soldiers in Tim O'Brien's The Things They Carried, the early Christians carried with them the constant threat of terrible things happening to them. So how do people in such a pressure cooker world with so many problems produce something like the scripture that we read today? How could people who could literally be thrown to the lions at any moment speak with such hope about a river of life, about the goodness of God, about the darkness being dissipated and chased away by the light of Jesus, about the victory of life over death? Well, I'd submit to you that those people under pressure could produce something like that because they carried with them not just the danger, not just the struggle, not just the worry, not just the problems, but something else: hope. Looking at the world through the eyes of faith doesn't mean pretending the problems aren't real or that they'll go away by themselves without us doing anything. It doesn't mean thinking that bad things could never happen to me or to my loved ones, or that I'll never cry, that I'll never be angry with God. Hope doesn't mean that I'll be wealthy and powerful and successful. And in fact, if I truly pattern my life after Jesus, I should probably expect the exact opposite. But hope does mean that I will not give in to despair, that the darkness will not hold me captive. It means that I will believe that God is working for my good, even when bad things are happening around me. It means that I will trust whatever jungle I wade through, whatever struggle is real, that God will be with me through it. One of my favorite college bands back in my day, okay, when we, you know, rode to school on horses, used to sing, "Everywhere you go, you always take the weather with you." In other words, your outlook on your past, on your present, on your prospects for your future, those things will go a long way in determining your experience of the world. If all you see is sun, you're probably fooling yourselves and nobody's going to trust you. If all you see is rain, then all you'll experience is clouds and sorrow and negativity, and no one's going to want to be around you. So I'm not asking you to pretend things are other than they are. I'm not asking you to be dishonest, to always put on a happy face no matter what. But I am asking you to leave here today, some of you as graduates, some of you leaving here forever, that you're careful about what you carry. Take good weather with you. Take things that really matter with you. The rest is just baggage. Carry your memories. Carry your crosses. Carry compassion. Carry love of your neighbor. But among these things, carry hope. Always carry hope, regardless of your circumstances. Because this is the good news. Surely God is with us. Amen. Let us pray. God, we thank you for the witness of those that have gone before us, who remind us that hope is not just a feeling, that hope is not futile, but rather that hope is a spiritual discipline that carries us through. We pray that you would carry us this day, and all those that are graduating here and other places. We pray this together in Jesus' name. Amen.
We'll invite invite you to worship with us. We know that this will be a new song for many of you, and so we would invite you to worship freely as you get to know the song. We'd encourage you to sing along, or to simply sit and kind of bathe in these words as we consider how to live lives of praise as we leave this place today. But we'd encourage you to stand with us. Let's go ahead and join our voices together.
Give all. Dear Heavenly Father, we give you thanks for the life of Professor Boleen, Pam Boleen. Like you, she was a teacher and gave continually of herself for the students of Dakota Wesleyan University. Comfort her family, the DWU students, and her faculty colleagues as we continually are filled with sadness at her absence among us. Help each of Pam's students to have pride in what they have learned from her. Help all of us to always care for each other and to say thank you to God every day for the people placed in our lives. All the individuals like Pam who love and help us as we grow in knowing and maturity. We again place Professor Pam Boleen into your loving hands. Thank you for allowing us to experience your love through her. Amen.
Would you all pray with me? Heavenly Father, we thank you for allowing us to be here today on this beautiful day. We thank you for everyone who's helped be part of this journey and helping us do something that's very hard to accomplish. Particularly, we thank you for our mothers on this Mother's Day. We thank you for being with us through all the struggles and all the hardships over the years. And even though some of us might not know exactly where we're going in life forward past this, we ask that you be with us and look over us and just be there and guide us through this journey. We will now pray the way that Jesus taught his disciples, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us for our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
Would you please stand? And recite the benediction with me. My Lord God, I have no idea where I am going. I do not see the road ahead of me. I cannot know for certain where it will end. Nor do I really know myself, and the fact that I think that I am following your will does not mean that I am actually doing so. But I believe that the desire to please you does in fact please you. And I hope I have that desire in all that I am doing. I hope that I will never do anything apart from that desire. And I know that if I do this, you will lead me by the right road, though I may know nothing about it. Therefore, I will trust you always, though I may seem to be lost and in the shadow of death. I will not fear, for you are ever with me, and you will never leave me to face my perils alone. Amen.